Without movement, the church is dead. Without new things being unfolded, without new truth coming out, new light coming, it's over. You're no longer part of the movement of God. You know, but people say, oh, it's so divisive. But that's the point. That's the point. It's got to be something. Something that changes the way you think. The forgotten revolutionary, it may sound a little bit ambiguous, and it's going to largely be on the Reformation, and more specifically the Radical Reformation, which is something that I hadn't heard of until I looked into it, and it was a strange thing that I'd never heard of it. I know many of us haven't heard about the Radical Reformation, but these people, the truths that we enjoy, we don't owe them to the main body of reformers that are well known. We owe it to these people. But they're forgotten, and I'm going to explain why. In Ecclesiastes, Solomon says, "This wisdom have I seen also under the sun, and it seemed great unto me. There was a little city and few men within it, and there came a great king against it, and besieged it, and built great bulwarks against it. Now there was found in it a poor wise man, and he by his wisdom delivered the city, yet no man remembered that same poor man." I'm sure this is a true story that Solomon was aware of. And this poor man that delivered the city, no one thought of him. No one regarded what he had done. And obviously he was poor. Maybe he lacked charisma. Maybe he had a rough manner. I surmise that there was some smooth-talking captain of the army that perhaps had taken the credit. Someone that had charisma. Someone that was a bit of a showman, he took the credit. And that is often the case. The people that bless the most are forgotten in history and even by their contemporaries. In Proverbs, Solomon also commenting, he says, "The poor is hated even of his own neighbor, but the rich hath many friends." Why is the poor hated of his own neighbor? Because people have nothing to gain through association with the poor. Selfish people have nothing to gain through association with them. They only have a loss. They want to stay away from them because they feel obligated to help them. We're talking about monetary poor. But what about the poor as far as the downtrodden of this world, the persecuted? By associating with them, you yourself become the target of attacks. So the poor is hated. The poor not only in wealth, but the poor of this world, the persecuted, are shunned. The rich, the loved, the popular, they're the ones that people gravitate to for advantage. This is a truth, and this is, I believe, the reason why these people we're going to talk about are forgotten, and why the people today, the revolutionaries today, are very little esteemed. Who else was despised? We read about Jesus. He was despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. See, this is the pattern that most revolutionary men of God have always followed in the world's eyes, especially Jesus. So we've all heard of Martin Luther, John Calvin, Zwingli, and the main body of reformers. What about these fellows? George Blaurock, which means blue coat in German. Konrad Grebel. Felix Manz. Ever heard of them? Unlikely. I hadn't. These are the poor men that were not remembered. And it's from these men and people who did the same as them that we have so many of the truths that we love. These were the real heroes of the Reformation. Not just these, but other ones. They are the forgotten revolutionaries. I've got this book that I've read. It was an amazing book called The Anabaptist Story. And he explains a little bit of this mystery as to why these men were forgotten. He says, "The history of Anabaptism belongs to the category of now it can be told stories. Perhaps there is no group within Christian history that has been judged as unfairly as the Anabaptists of the 16th century. Theirs has been the lot of the widely misunderstood, deliberately misrepresented, or completely ignored, with the exception of the present generation But a handful of competent historians have joined in a thumbs-down treatment of four centuries' duration. See, even great historians like Merle d'Aubigné, they describe these men as extremists. And as you said, a thumbs-down treatment was given to them. That's why we don't know anything about them. Even the pioneers of Adventism, they largely were unaware of these. You read in Great Controversy, you read a lot about Martin Luther and these people, but it's because the information about these people was widely ignored by a body of historians of their own time. Therefore, people of later generations, the information wasn't even available to them. When we think of a revolutionary, we tend to think of people like Robespierre and Lenin, these violent, bloody men. Let's just read a little account of Merle d'Aubigné in his great book, History of the Reformation of the 16th Century. He says, "The history of one of the greatest revolutions that has ever been accomplished in human affairs, of a mighty impulse communicated to the world three centuries ago, is the object of my present undertaking." So he styles the Reformation a revolution, a mighty impulse. I love that because it really was. It was something that was going forward, something that was going forward with aggressive pace. And the term revolutionary, it really just is one engaged in revolution, an advocate or adherent of revolutionary doctrines. And no doubt the reformers were. What's the antonym? Middle of the road or moderate? They certainly, many of them became that. But to be really, you know, a true Christian makes you a revolutionary. He continues to say, "The term revolution, which I here apply it to the Reformation, has of late fallen into discredit with many individuals who almost confound it with revolt. But they are wrong, for a revolution is merely a change in the affairs of men, something new unfolded, revolvo from the bosom of humanity. And this very word, previous to the end of the last century, was more frequently used in a good than in a bad sense. A happy, wonderful revolution were the terms employed." So it's something new unfolded, a change in the affairs of men. When we think of the revolution such as, you know, that of the communism or even the French Revolution, the hook was the state of affairs that those people were in. Without the corruption of the Catholic Church and the monarchy in France, the revolution could never have happened. Same with in Russia, the peasants were being mistreated. So that gave occasion for someone to rise up and say that they're here to save the day, you know, all these deceitful, you know, Marxists. And that word revolvo there, which revolution comes from, means to again roll. It implies movement. God's church is a movement. It's described as a movement. We're told it's a movement. When the church stops to be a movement, it really stops to be God's true church. Without movement, the church is dead. Without new things being unfolded, without new truth coming out, new light coming, it's over. You're no longer part of the movement of God. And he continues, "Primitive Christianity and the Reformation are the two greatest revolutions in history. Primitive Christianity and the Reformation are one and the same revolution brought about at different epochs and under different circumstances. One is a repetition of the other. The former put an end to the old world and the latter began the new. Between them lie the Middle Ages." So they're one and the same revolution. And remember why? Because of the revolutionary teachings. That's what a revolutionary is, someone that is an adherent or a teacher of revolutionary doctrines. But what makes teachings revolutionary? What does it mean they're some harebrained thing that's off the wall and different that people have never heard? No, not really. Were Jesus' teachings revolutionary? Absolutely. In Isaiah, it says, "The Lord is well pleased for his righteousness' sake. He will magnify the law and make it honorable." He was to magnify the law. Jesus says, "I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill." In his Sermon on the Mount, he showed that God's law is based upon the broad foundation of love to God and love to man. He revealed truths that had been buried under the rubbish of error. It was the rubbish of error that had made what he was teaching revolutionary. Of course, he expanded and beyond measure what was in the Old Testament with what he taught. But it was because of the rubbish of error that they were so revolutionary. People had changed the law or the you know, the Torah into a book of legalism. But Jesus showed, no, it's based on love, the love to God and love to man. So, and that revolution continued after his death and resurrection by the disciples until formalism came in and smothered that movement finally, which ended up in the establishment of the papacy and the church went into the wilderness. After 1,000 years later, though, God again sparked up that revolutionary spirit among the general population through Martin Luther when he nailed that 95 Theses to the door of a church in Wittenberg. Let's just have a quick look at some of the points of the 95 Theses. Point 6, the Pope cannot remit any guilt except by declaring and showing it has been remitted by God. See, this was revolutionary at the time, but this is based on Scripture. The revolutions in the Bible, revolutions that God leads, always comes back to the Bible. 1 Timothy 2:5, which says, there is one God and one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus. What about point 32? Those who believe that they can be certain of their salvation because they have indulgence letters will be eternally damned together with their teachers. You might have got that from Acts 8:20. Talking about Simon the sorcerer, Peter says, thy money perish with thee because thou hast thought that the gift of God may be purchased with money. What about point 36? Any truly repentant Christian has a right to full remission of penalty and guilt, even without indulgence letters. Knowing the Bible, Martin Luther might have been thinking of Romans 3:24 that says, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. See, this revolution was based in his understanding of the Bible. That's what made it revolutionary. And the revolution, what made it revolutionary was the rubbish of error that had buried these truths. And within months, many German states had gone with Luther, and later a third of Europe went with him in this revolution. Just because of one man who was not afraid to speak his convictions, that was the catalyst. There was a lot of discontent around already, but someone had to start it. Now, Martin Luther, along with John Calvin, Zwingli, the rest of the reformers, they were very well-educated men. Quick-witted, you can see in Luther's responses to Dr. Eck when he had that famous debate with him. And not only that, he was famous now. He was famous. These men should have been unstoppable as far as it goes to continuing this revolution, to bringing about the restitution of all things. But sadly, they didn't. They stopped. They didn't go any further. After a few years, it was pretty much for these guys. It was pretty much over. That's just the reality. God used them mightily, as we read here. This is a well-known quote by James White. He says, Martin Luther and other reformers arose in the strength of God and with the Word and Spirit made mighty strides in the Reformation. Indeed, they did. However, the greatest fault we can find in the Reformation is the reformers stopped reforming. Had they gone on and onward till they had left the last vestige of the papacy behind, such as natural immortality, sprinkling, the Trinity, and Sunday keeping, the church would now be free from her unscriptural errors. I don't say this to criticize them. You know, that's not my intention here. I'm saying these things to show that we don't want to fall into the same errors that these guys fell into. Because it has had terrible effects on Europe. Many people were killed and died, and the truth was trampled to the ground by the blindness of the chosen religious leaders of God. These men, the main body of reformers, opposed the Sabbath. They opposed true righteousness by faith because they didn't understand, like Luther called James's book, an epistle straw. They attacked believers' baptism, communion, because obviously believers' baptism because they continue to sprinkle infants. They opposed communion because they had their own versions, modified versions of the Mass. They fought for the union of church and state. They trampled on liberty of conscience, and they also promoted the use of the sword. Did God want these men to champion these truths? Of course he would. He would have used them because they were the best men around. But because they wouldn't go forward, he had to turn to others who were inferior to them in as far as learning and ability is concerned, absolutely. It's like how Jesus said, if these hold their peace, the stones will cry out. When people refuse to go forward, God always moves on to others. Others who are inferior. He moves on the most capable first. Just like how when Jesus was born in Bethlehem, he passed by the chief priests of Israel and turned to the wise men in the east, the heathen men, to come and to see Jesus, who knew the prophecies. They knew something about God, but they weren't his professed people. And the angels appeared to those poor shepherds in the fields. See, God always works this way. His truth has to be told, and he'll use anyone. It's better if he can use the those with aptitude. So really, sola scriptura, they didn't really live up to it. You know, I'm not saying that to criticize, but this is just the truth. So God raised up others, what we know as the Radical Reformation, or what is called the Radical Reformation. We may not even know about any Radical Reformation. I didn't. And the key feature of the Radical Reformation, another sort of synonymous term for them, these people, was the Anabaptists. And all that really means is the re-Baptists. It was actually a slight against them that the Reformers and the Catholics used. They didn't call themselves re-Baptists because they said rightly that the infant baptism was invalid. It's like Methodists. Methodists was a derogatory term used against John Wesley's people, but it stuck. The primary issue between the Reformers and the Radical Reformers was infant baptism. That was their parting of the ways. Why would that have been such an issue when clearly there's not zero verses to support such an idea? Why would the Reformers cling so tenaciously to this infant baptism? The reason they compromised was they put policy and organization rather than principle and truth. They thought, what's going to happen to us, rather, is this the truth? Is this what God is saying? Sola scriptura went out the window in favor of tradition. Since Constantine, there had been a union of church and state among all the Christians, all the churches, and obviously the papacy had done this. And the Reformers sought to maintain this unbiblical state of affairs within their domains. Luther just... They became Lutherans, and they had a Lutheran church and state. The Lutheran church is still part of the state today. They ditched the Roman church and state and basically set up their own version of it. They didn't change that. And the reason they rejected believers' baptism was due to this church and state they wanted to hold to. Because believers' baptism meant that you had now a free church instead of a state church. Because if baptism is voluntary and taken and something that you do upon the age of reason, church membership is therefore voluntary and optional. And that means you have a free church that is independent of the state. And when you have a free church independent of the state, you therefore void the protection of the state against foreign enemies or invaders, which is the duty of the state among the combined church-state system. So this is the reason they rejected it. They thought maybe the Turks were going to come in and wipe them all out or something like that. To Zwingli and Luther, this idea of a free church without the protection of the state was unacceptable. They lacked faith in God to build the church on the apostolic model, which is what the Anabaptists were doing. And we can see here it wasn't because they didn't reject it over any doctrinal or any argument besides this. They didn't come out and say it, but you can put it together. Who's heard of Balthasar Hubmaier? No. Very few. I hadn't heard of him either. Like, this man, the things that he spoke, you think it's E.J. Wagner talking. This was in 1500s. This man, along with many others, they were dialoguing with Zwingli and Luther. They were all in converse about this idea of infant baptism and the mass and images. And Hubmaier, he details that Zwingli agreed with me that children should not be baptized before they are instructed in the faith. He agreed with him when they were talking before the parting of the ways. So he ascended to that, that was the truth. However, when he went back to Switzerland, there was a lot of young radicals, the ones that we were talking about before. Konrad Grebel, Felix Manz, and Blaurock. They were Swiss. They were having these public debates about all these doctrines, and they started to get disillusioned with Zwingli because Zwingli wasn't moving forward. They actually were his students, and then they started to excel him, and he started to compromise. This is a book, The Reformation and the Advent Movement. It details why Zwingli drew back on this. Now, Zwingli realized the far-reaching implications of substituting believers' baptism for the baptism of infants. He saw that it would inevitably breach the principle of the union of church and state, which he was so anxious to preserve, and would establish the revolutionary principle of a free church independent of the state. Like Luther, he drew back. "It is better not to preach it," he declared, "until the world is ready to hear it." See, it was because of temporal concerns that he drew back there. He didn't want to avoid the protection of the state, but there were some that had more courage than Zwingli, the ones that are forgotten. After a series of disputations between these brothers and Zwingli in the council hall, Zwingli finally started to attack them publicly. By the end of 1524, Zwingli was being so pressed by the evangelicals, that's the Anabaptists, that he wrote a pamphlet against them titled, "Who Causes Tumult?" Bitterly, he called Grebel and his associates Satans going about as angels of light. It is significant, however, that even in this tense situation, Zwingli did not criticize them in regard to doctrines which concern the inner man. What was his issue with them? It was, "Oh, you're being divisive." You know, in regard to doctrine, there's nothing, we have no issue. You know, he couldn't fight them in doctrine because they were right. They had 1,000 scriptures for what they believed. But he's saying, no, this is divisive. This is inconvenient for us at this time. And therefore, and he even goes forward to call them Satans. You know, there's a danger in calling evil good and good evil. What's the sin against the Holy Spirit? Accounting to Satan the working of God. I'm not saying he sinned against the Holy Spirit, but that's what it is. Eventually, after a public disputation in 1525, Grebel, Manz, and Blaurock were forbidden to meet as a school. All unbaptized infants must be baptized within 8 days on pain of exile. That was an order from the council, which was Zwingli's was kind of the head of the church state council there. You can imagine how these brothers felt. You know, I'm sure we've all felt that way before many times. I'm sure they felt a little bit like Jeremiah did when he said, "Then I said, I will not make mention of him, nor speak any more in his name. But his word was in mine heart as a burning fire shut up in my bones, and I was weary with forbearing, and I could not stay." See, when God puts a love for the truth in your heart, you can't be quiet about it. You can't unsee what he's shown you. To do so is to violate your conscience. Song of Solomon 8:7 says, "Many waters cannot quench love, neither can the floods drown it." That love for the truth, it can't be put out, you know, and that's a beautiful thing. And God put that in your heart. And a baptism was born from that very action of Zwingli in condemning them by the law with these brothers and others. A few days after this decree of Zwingli, the council, the brothers met together as a school, as they were told not to do. And it came to pass that they were together until anxiety came upon them. Yes, they were so pressed within their hearts. Thereupon they began to bow their knees to the Most High God in heaven and called upon him as the informer of hearts. And they prayed that he would give them his divine will and that he would show his mercy unto them. For flesh and blood and human frowardness did not drive them, since they well knew that they would have to suffer on account of it. After prayer, George Blaurock stood up and besought Konrad Grebel for God's sake to baptize him with the true baptism upon his faith and knowledge. And when he knelt down with such a request and desire, Konrad baptized him, since at that time there was no ordained minister to perform such work. So they understood baptism to be pouring, but that's what they knew. So up until now they hadn't moved forward with this, but they realized that they were on their own. So they went forward. This was when Anabaptism was born, this moment in Felix Munz's house. William Estep, the Anabaptist story, comments on this. He says, "With this first baptism, the earliest church of the Swiss Brethren was constituted. This was clearly the most revolutionary act of the Reformation. He even puts it above what Luther did. No other event so completely symbolized the break with Rome. Here, for the first time in the course of the Reformation, a group of Christians dared to form a church after what was conceived to be the New Testament pattern. See, Luther's 95 Theses, he actually hoped to stay with Rome after that. He didn't really mean that in the way it was taken. But this act, you know, this was just starting a free church. This was very revolutionary, even though it was done in secret. It was, well, not really in secret, but among them. It truly was a big step to take. After Rebel baptized Blarock, he baptized all of them. They went out from there and started baptizing people all over the place, and they were arrested and they escaped, and they were arrested again and they were released, and eventually they started being executed by the Protestants. We read here in the Reformation and the Advent movement, on March 17, a mandate was issued by Zurich in Switzerland to the effect that henceforth in our city, territory and neighborhood, no man, woman or maiden shall re-baptize another. Whosoever shall do so shall be arrested by the authority, and after proper judgment shall without appeal be put to death by drowning. The Protestants began drowning people for being baptized. They began killing other Protestants. See the graphic there? They'd tie your hands below your knees and put a stick between your legs and chuck you in the river. I guess it wasn't as bad as burning, but still, it's just totally wrong to do. Yeah. And all that comes back to, down to this love for the union of church and state. This inability to move past it. Terrible. Felix Manz was drowned in a lake near Zurich in 1527, the first martyr at the hands of Protestants. Blarock was burned by Catholics in Tyrol in 1529. He'd escaped from Switzerland because he'd been captured and managed to escape. He escaped into a Catholic place and they burned him at the stake. Greville had died of plague in 1526. By 1529, all the original Anabaptist preachers were dead. The Anabaptists had the shortest lifespan of any of the Reformations by far. From this point, for hundreds of years, these people would go from one protectorate from one duke's territory who'd be favorable to them, and they'd change and they'd have to flee to another, and then that person would either turn on them or accept them, and that they were vagabonds. They were fugitives. They were constantly moving all around Europe. Everyone hated them, Catholics and Protestants. They were the most despised of all Christians, the most persecuted of all. I wish I could put more of their stories in here, but there's not enough time. But what about the Second Diet of Speyer, the protest of the princes? You know, that was a glorious moment for Protestantism. Charles V, he successfully enacted a law which was passed by the majority of the princes of the Holy Roman Empire to halt the Reformation, which restricted Protestants from evangelizing and to stop the Reformation. But there was a minority of princes that protested. They refused to accept. It didn't change the law. The law was the law, but they protested, and it was marked. It was an act of bravery because they were in the minority. The others could have just wiped them out. And this was their protest. This is where the name Protestant comes from, by the way. We protest by these presents before God, our only creator, preserver, redeemer, and savior, and who will one day be our judge, as well as before all men and all creatures, that we, for us and for our people, neither consent nor adhere in any manner whatsoever to the proposed decree, in anything that is contrary to God, to his holy word, to our right of conscience, to the salvation of our souls. See, this was the Protestant princes, right? They protested. You know, even though they were outnumbered and there was nothing they could do, they wanted them to know that we do not agree with this. We make a protest. And that was brave, you know, because, you know, they put themselves at risk there. However, you know, as noble and true as this is, you know, that's that to our right conscience. Only 4 days later, the same princes that had protested the unjust law against them consented to a mandate of Charles V against the Anabaptists, which said, and this was 4 days later, 1529, whereas it is ordered and provided in common law that no man, having once been baptized according to Christian order, infant, shall let himself be baptized again, It is forbidden in the imperial law to do such on pain of death. Every Anabaptist and rebaptized man and woman of the age of reason shall be condemned and brought forth from natural life into death by fire, sword, and the like. So much for, protesting. The glory of the Reformation was tainted by the shameful abandonment of people who believe differently to them, you know. See, we don't know about these details. Some of the sentiments of John Calvin: we have sharpened the sword that they, the civil authorities, may accomplish their blood work. See, they consented to these decrees. Even Melanchthon, he said, all the Anabaptists, even if they are blameless in all other aspects, reject some part or other of their civic duties. Though the matter in and for itself may be insignificant, yet at this time and in so many crises, it is extremely dangerous. Therefore, it is my opinion concerning those who hold beliefs that are, to be sure, not seditious, but still obviously blasphemous, that the government is under obligation to kill them. Can you see where compromise leads? Can you see where this wrong idea, you can understand when Jesus says that the love of many shall wax cold, and then many shall betray one another and hate one another. You can see where that happens. It's just a little bit of compromise. I'm not saying these guys are lost or bad people, or, I mean, the statements are pretty harsh, but like, it's just compromise. It's a terrible slippery slope. See how he says there, reject some part or other of their civic duties. I believe he's talking about the bearing arms for the state. The Protestants and the Catholics, the reason they hated Anabaptism was because the Anabaptists, by and large, were non-combatants. They didn't fight in wars. And they were all afraid of the Turks invading. And they thought that if Anabaptism spread, then no one would fight their battles and the Turks would take Europe. So you've got to kill them so that people don't get poisoned with this idea that you shouldn't kill men. So we've seen now that it was policy. It was fear of the loss of their organization that caused them to think like this. It wasn't their beliefs. See how he says their beliefs? Yeah, he says their beliefs. What were their beliefs? What was so radical about them? We're just going to have a little bit. There's so many things I could have gone on and talked about, but we can't cover it all in one study. I highly recommend studying this subject. Very interesting if you like history of the Reformation. Balthasar Hubmaier was what you would call the theologian of the radicals, of the Anabaptists. He was an up-and-coming Catholic priest, actually. He was noted for his impressive ritual in his town, I think it was called Waldschut in Austria. But in 1522, he met Erasmus and other reformers, began reading Erasmus's New Testament, and went back to his local parish. He started implementing what he learned, which was taking down images and many things, and basically became a reformer, gradually but surely. And he won the whole city, his whole city council, to the Reformation side. They actually were willing to protect him, even in war. They loved him that much. He converted the city, basically. But eventually, the Ferdinand I, the Austrian Archduke at the time, he sent forces to clear him out. The city was willing to fight for him, but he said, no, I'll leave. And he became, from 1524, became a fugitive until his death at the hands of Ferdinand in 1528. Initially, this man was aligned with Zwingli until he published his ideas on infant baptism. The meaning of this sign and symbol, the pledge of faith unto death in hope of the resurrection to the life to come, is to be considered more than a sign. It has nothing to do with babes. Therefore, infant baptism is without validity. You see what he's saying here? Like, you've got to remember, this was right in the dark age of 1525. The Reformation had just begun. For people to understand things and say things like this is extremely revolutionary. Like, clearly that's what the Bible teaches, but, you know, it's far beyond his time. Zwingli wrote a response defending himself in the pamphlet, and they began a bit of a war between the two. Part of Hubmaier's response: baptism in water is not what cleanses the soul, but the yes of a good conscience toward God, given inwardly by faith. Not that through its sins are forgiven, but by virtue of the inward yes of the heart, which a man outwardly testifies on submitting to water baptism. They're very broad views that he has. You think that's something written by Wagner or something like that. This is where these men, a lot of the pioneers, got a lot of their truth from. He'd only been reading the Bible for 3 years. eventually, Hubmaier was, he was still in Austria, but eventually Ferdinand's armies got closer to the village he was hiding out in. So he had to flee, and the only place he could go was where Zwingli was in Zurich. So when he arrived in Zurich, he was promptly arrested. And after a public disputation with Zwingli, which the council decided that he lost and that he was a heretic, obviously regarding baptism, he was ordered to recant. He refused. So they tortured him on the rack. They stretched him out on the rack, forced a recantation out of him, which he did give. But when he left, he obviously unrecanted. They booted him out of the city. And we read here in Anabaptist story, he referred to Zwingli, who by capture, imprisonment, and suffering in the hangman, tried to teach me the faith. I love the style of this man. But faith is a work of God and not of the heretic's tower. He said, a heretic I cannot be, because he loved the truth. See, he understood liberty of conscience. None of the reformers did. They said that the people should be killed who don't agree with them. He wrote a pamphlet in 1524 called Concerning Heretics and Those That Burn Them, those that deceitfully undermine the Holy Scriptures, and also those that conceal the Scriptures and interpret them other than the Holy Spirit demands. Obviously, he's talking about papists there largely, but he does talk about heretics generally as people that reject the Scriptures. However, his revolutionary views on how to deal with them is a significant part of this pamphlet. Therefore, it is well and good that the secular authority puts to death the criminals that do physical harm to the defenseless, as per Romans 13, but no one may injure the enemy of God who wishes nothing for himself than to forsake the gospel. They're like, you know, obviously we think, oh, of course, you know, today, like, of course we, but back then, people thought it was right to kill those who reject to go to church. The darkness they're in, these are very impressive sentiments to come out of that age. We can't fathom them today, but the man that is credited with champion religious liberty is Roger Williams. We read about him in Great Controversy. And indeed he did. Williams reprobated the law. The worst statute in the English code was that which did but enforce attendance upon the parish church. To compel men to unite with those of a different creed, he regarded as an open violation of their natural rights. To drag to public worship the irreligious and the unwilling seemed only like requiring hypocrisy. No one should be bound to worship or, he added, to maintain a worship against his own consent. By the way, this was what was happening in the American colonies in the beginning. People being forced to worship. And one of the colonists said, "What?" exclaimed his antagonist, amazed at his tenets. "Is not the laborer worthy of his hire?" "Yes," replied he, "from them that hire him." Attending church should be voluntary. Paying the minister of your tithe is voluntary. All these things should be voluntary. He understood this. You can see this is over 100 years later, and he's saying this. It still wasn't understood. But Hubmaier, if just a few years after the Reformation began, he was saying it. These ideas, Roger, he didn't come up with these. These were handed down to him by the people that he were involved with, which go back to Hubmaier and the Anabaptists. That's where he got these high ideals from. Roger Williams was part of a group known as the English Separatists. They were not the Puritans. They were basically who the pilgrims were that came to, a lot of them were that came to the New World. But they were, the English Separatists got their ideas from the Dutch Anabaptists, because we know that they traveled between the two places. And one of the first English Separatists was called John Smith. And he wrote this beautiful statement when they left the state church. John Smith wrote this. They shook off this yoke of anti-Christian bondage, this church and state union that they were part of. And as the Lord's free people joined themselves into a church estate, the fellowship of the gospel, to walk together in all his ways made known, or to be made known unto them, according to their best endeavors, whatsoever it should cost them, the Lord working with them. Notice that. To walk together in all his ways made known, or to be made known. Sister White says, here was the true spirit of reform, the vital principle of Protestantism. This is what makes God's people a movement. Not only to walk together in the truth you already have, but to be willing to be shown truth, to be willing to move forward in truth that God allows to shine on you. Not just to know it, but to walk. What he says there, to walk together, to go forward with it. And if we don't, God passes us by. That's how it works. That's how God has always worked, and he'll continue to work that way. God's movement is a revolution. A revolution that began with Jesus, that was sparked again during the Reformation, that continued with the radical reformers, and of course the truth given to the Advent movement, you know, which it's waxed and waned over time. It's always at times when things get very oppressive and in the world gets more and more controlled that these revolutions really spark up. See, what's the recipe for a revolution? You need revolutionaries, but you also need widespread disillusionment and dissatisfaction. These are two vital things, I believe, for a revolution, whether it's a good one or one of these Marxist ones. These two things have always been there. Now, the Reformation had this, as d'Aubigné tells us. Many circumstances which have often passed unnoticed gradually prepared the world for the great transformation of the 16th century, so that the human mind was ripe when the hour of its emancipation arrived. People had become sick of the clergy, the corrupt clergy, you know, and their debauchery they were practicing. They were sick of the extortion that was being practiced on the hardworking German people, taking all their money for their, you know, grand buildings in Rome. They had enough. Luther was just the catalyst that came forth, and everyone said, yes, that's right. No, I'm going with you. What about apostolic Christianity? The enfeebled world was tottering on its foundations when Christianity appeared. The national religions which had satisfied the parents no longer proved sufficient for their children. The new generations could not repose contented with the ancient forms. The gods of every nation, when transported to Rome, there lost their oracles, and the nations themselves had there lost their liberty. Brought face to face in the capital, they had destroyed each other and their divinity had vanished. A great void was occasioned in the religion of the world. The nation's identities were dissolved in this new world order, which was the Roman Empire at the time. A kind of deism, destitute alike of spirit and life, floated for a time above the abyss in which the vigorous superstitions of antiquity had been engulfed. But like all negative creeds, it had no power to reconstruct. National possessions disappeared with the fall of national gods. The various kingdoms melted one into the other. In Europe, Asia, and Africa, there was but one vast empire, and the human race began to feel its universality and unity. Then the Word was made flesh. The world was ripe for Christianity back then. People don't like when there's a new world order. They don't like being controlled and being made slaves and poor and, you know, they don't like their identities being taken away. So God always acts at these times, these crucial times. These are the times when revolutions can come, when there's widespread disillusionment and dissatisfaction. Do we have that now? Are we seeing that now? The globalists, for lack of a better word, have everyone wearing the same brand name clothes, listening to the same trashy Hollywood music and movies, hearing the same phony narratives on mainstream media, the same boogeyman, the climate change, the coronavirus, terrorism, the same false educations being forced down everyone's throats, the bogus science dribble we've been told to believe, we came from slime and apes. People are sick of the tricks of politicians, lying to them every term, this phony two-part paradigm. People are crying out for a truth that can shatter this phony paradigm that they're in. People, not everyone, but there's many people that they hate this. They hate this you know, phony reality that's been made around them. There's nothing but lies. And the flat earth, the truth, the biblical cosmology is like a sledgehammer. Destroy that paradigm in a second if people accept this. When you accept this, you can accept you've been lied to about everything. And not only that, it leads you to the Bible. It leads you to the Sabbath. It'll cause that paradigm shift that you need to believe the truth. You know, but people say, oh, it's so divisive. But that's the point. That's the point. It's got to be something. Something that changes the way you think. The wisdom of God in bringing this. People think, oh, what will happen to my following? People will laugh at me. You know, these are the same reasonings that killed the Reformation. The same reasonings that led the reformers to kill the radicals. Compromise is a slippery slope. And we'll end with the story about the poor wise man. As we read here, Solomon continues after he talks about the city being taken. He says, "Then I said, wisdom is better than strength. Nevertheless, the poor man's wisdom is despised and his words are not heard." Why is the poor man's wisdom despised again? Because people have nothing to gain through association with him as far as this world's concerned. They have everything to lose. They despise his wisdom because, no, I don't want to associate with that guy. I want the popular, you know, the rich man. He can benefit me as far as this world's concerned. The reformers despised the Anabaptist message because they saw nothing but death from their temporal enemies for it. Putting temporal security before truth destroys the movement. You put yourself out of the movement. It works against you. God works exclusively through those who are willing to go forward with light that he permits to shine on them. And Solomon continues, "The words of wise men are heard in quiet more than the cry of him that ruleth among fools." See, it's called a remnant, God's remnant, because it's never the majority. The rest have been taken away. That's what the remnant is. And the reason they aren't taken away is because they love the truth and they don't care about their temporal interests. I'll close with the signature that Hubmaier placed at the end of all of his tracts. Truth is immortal. They might kill us, but they can never kill the truth. You know, and that's what he cared about. He went to his death for what he believed. You know, and maybe many of his people will. I'm sure many people, and the Bible says many people will too, but truth is immortal, and only those who want immortality have to have the same love for the truth. That's the only thing that will save you. In fact, the Bible says that they receive not the love of the truth that they might be saved. So therefore, the only way you are saved is if you receive the love of the truth. And that truth is in his word, which includes Genesis 1. Okay, I invite you to kneel with me as we close with prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you that you haven't left us without that safe anchor that we have in trusting in your word. We pray that our faith might take hold of it, that it will not be as those that drew back during the Reformation and thought about their temporal safety or prosperity, Lord, but that we would just ask, what is it you will have me to do? Your word says that he that shall do his will shall know of the doctrine, Lord, and we pray that we will always be willing to do your will, that we might know of the doctrine. Please bless us the rest of this Sabbath. We pray and we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.